Yeah, you can start your life.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome for today's interactive session on epidemiological studies. We have with us Dr. Tilak Sura, sir, who is an associate professor, Department of Community Medicine in Kerala. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you for the opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, before I go into this section, I just want to tell the participant, I'm not going into detail about each study design. I'm just what to try to tell today is, so how to identify which study to be followed or which study to be used to do any study, okay? In a given scenario, which study should be used? So I may ask some questions in between. So those who are seeing, if you know, you can make more little bit interactive so that you can put a message in chat, or you can unmute yourself and you can say the answer also. Okay. Yeah. So shall we start?
Yes, okay. Sir.
Yeah. Okay. Today we just wanted to discuss about the important topic, that is epidemiological study designs. So in epidemiological study designs, there are so many study designs. Okay. But in that we only discuss important points. What are different type of study designs we are having? So what are the analysis we do for that study to come out, to say that this study is better or not like that? Okay. So before that, before we go to exact study designs, we should know what is epidemiology. Slideshow is not happening. Okay, 1 minute.
Sure, sir, no problems.
Sharing is happening a little bit slow. 1 minute. Yeah. Okay. So, what is epidemiology? So, so many times we might have heard about this. Like, this will be asked in Viva, in practicals, even in your theory exams. Also, we'll ask this definition. What is epidemiology? So, epidemiology is study of the occurrence and distribution of health-related events. Maybe states also, even processes also, in a specific population. We have to define the exact population. So it includes the study of the determinants influencing such processes. Like, for example, now if you take COVID, so we are trying to do how many people are getting infected, how many people are getting hospitalized, how many people are requiring are asymptomatic, how many people are requires ICU and all. Okay, such process, everything will be dealt. And application of this knowledge. So you are studying about the distribution occurrence of the health-related events, okay, in a specific population. And by knowing it, what you're trying to do, you're applying that whatever you know, got to know about by studying that occurrence and distribution. So you're trying to apply that knowledge to control the relevant health problems. That's what we're trying to do in the now present pandemic. We're trying to observe where it is happening, how it is happening, okay? Then what are the preventive measures to be taken based on the occurrence and distribution only we are trying to analyze, okay? So this epidemiology is very, very important in terms of in controlling the health problems, which is prevalent in that particular community. So in a specific population, defining the population is very, very important in epidemiology. So I cannot just say, I want to implement something to related to Karnataka. So I have to specifically tell it's related to Karnataka. If I don't say that, simply say that it's occurrence distribution of health events in all over the world means it will be difficult for us to implement the preventive measures, because each state, each country will have different cultural factors, different health specific indicators and all. So this will not help us to directly make us to implement the preventive measures. Okay, that's why WHO gives some guidelines. Based on the WHO guidelines, each country, each state can modify the guidelines based upon their requirement or the availability of the resources. I'm not able to move the slide. Hello.
So yes, sir. So if you want, you can share the PPT with me, sir. PPT. If it takes a 2 minute delay, sir, okay. I'll type my number in the chat box to you, sir.
Okay. Okay. Shravan is there?
Yes, sir. Shravan's here, sir.
Okay. 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 I'll just share this. Can you stop? Okay, just give me 1 minute. I have to mail this to my mail ID.
Sir, I've provided my mail ID also, sir.
Okay, then I'll send it to you directly.
Yes, sir.
Just a minute. Sorry for the mistake.
No problem, sir. Okay, sir.
Yeah, I just sent it to you. Meanwhile, yes, I'm just continuing with the whatever I'm having.
Sure. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. As soon as I receive it, I'll start sharing it, sir.
Yes, yes. Okay. Okay. So now we'll just continue with this one. Okay, so whenever we want to do some study, okay, so you got some ideas or some you want to do some study so you got some ideas. So whenever you get an idea, immediately we cannot start the research. Okay, to do some any research, you should have some study design. Okay, so for example, we'll discuss. So you got some idea like what is a vaccine, how to prepare a vaccine for this COVID, how we can prepare. So what study designs I should use to find out this efficacy, safety measures and all. Okay, that we'll discuss. And how, when you get the research idea, we cannot immediately jump to the research. So before doing the research, we have to try to find out which study design will fit better into my study design, our study research idea. If I wanted to check what is the prevalence of anemia in a particular community. So which study design I should use for that study to get the proper outcome or what are intended results I want to get. Okay, so without getting the, deciding the what study design you want to do, if you start doing the research, it won't be effective. We may not get the results that we wanted. Okay, so today we'll just discuss research designs. People will say research designs, study designs, epidemiological study designs and all. Okay, so I just show some case scenario, some scenarios I'm just asking you. So those who are live, just see. So prevalence of anemia, just keep in your mind. We'll discuss what are these type of, what study designs can be used to check prevalence of anemia, to check the clinical profile of leptospirosis and risk factors of low birth weight, and versus conventional suture versus stapler. Okay, so which should be used?
So I'm sharing the screen.
Yeah. Okay, I'll cancel the sharing.
So it will automatically cancel.
Okay.
Yes, is it visible?
Yeah, visible, visible.
Okay.
So can you go to the next slide? Next slide. Yeah, next slide. You can go to next slide. Yeah. So we are having some scenarios like what is the prevalence of anemia. To check prevalence of anemia, what study design we should we use? Anybody can comment.
The cross-sectional study design.
Cross-sectional. Okay, we'll discuss. Next one. Next slide. Clinical profile of leptospirosis. Which study design we can use? Shravan, you can put all the four scenarios. Yeah. So clinical profile of leptospirosis. Which study designs we can use? Okay, anybody can message or chat.
So we can try case series for clinical profile to check various set of cases.
Okay, we'll see. Yeah, risk factors for low birth weight. Yeah, okay, we'll case control. Okay, case control can be done. Okay, good. Next, now, what is the next scenario? Just go to next slide. Yeah, okay. Screen sharing is not happening properly, I think. Hello?
Sir, are you able to see the screen?
Screen, but it's not visible properly. Like what slide I sent, that slide is not visible, I think.
I think the problem is when we put it to Google.
Okay.
It just changes the format a little bit.
One minute. What I'll do, I'll just.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, minute. Share other. Okay. All right. This technical difficulties. One minute. Can I share, Shravan? Shravan, can I share? Yeah.
Yes, sir. You can share, sir. Stop.
Yeah. Yeah, after this, you can go back to your sharing, okay? So whenever we start doing the thinking about the study designs, okay? We should always think about some few three things. First, I will just tell about the different type of study designs we are having. So we are having like case study, case series, cross-section study, case control study, cohort study, randomized control trial, or non-randomized control trial. These are different study designs we are having. Okay, so whenever we try to do the study, any study or research, first you have to think about a few things. Whether I am going to do any exposure, assigning exposure, or whether I'm doing any intervention. Okay, if you see here in this, did investigator assign any exposures? Assign exposure or did investigator or did the you are doing any intervention? Okay. If you are doing any intervention to the study group, then it will become experimental study. Okay. If you are not doing any interventional, then it becomes observational study. Okay. In experimental study, we are having only two types. Okay. That we are having. So if you are doing random allocation, then it is called as randomized control trial. If you are not doing any random allocation, then it is called as non-randomized control trial. I'm not going in detail about what is random allocation. When we talk about RCT in maybe future classes, that time I will explain what is random allocation. Okay. So if you're not doing any intervention to the study group, you're just observing. Okay. You're just observing the people in what is happening to them. How is it happening? So is there any risk factors are available? Okay. Just observe. You're not doing anything. Okay, that is called as observational study. Next, you have to look for, are we having any comparison groups in the study designs? If we are having comparison group, then it will be analytical study. Okay, if there are no comparison groups, then it will become descriptive study. So what is descriptive study? So name itself says that description. I'm just describing the scenarios. Okay, that is descriptive study. The examples for descriptive studies are case study, case series, and cross-sectional study. Okay, so what is here in descriptive study, I'll just describe these number of people are got affected, these number of people got cured, these number of people are having the anemia, these number of people are having the diabetes. That's all. I'm just telling in numbers. Okay, I'm not telling anything about the what may be the factors causing the this number of diseases. Okay, I'm not telling anything. I'm just describing with respect to time, place, and person. Okay, that is called as descriptive study. In descriptive study, the basic thing what we talk about is case study, or we say case report. So what is case report? For example, you're practicing as a surgeon. Okay, so in your area, you find out that the patient's coming to you. One patient has come to you with a varicose vein. Okay, a patient has come to you with a varicose vein. You observe the patient. When you observe the patient, you found out that this is not a typical presentation of the varicose vein for that patient. So you feel that this is little bit deviated from the normal presentation. You feel that this to be reported to the public, or means for the your colleagues. So what you will do, you will take the details about all the history, what you have done for that patient, what are the challenges you faced during the operation or surgery. Okay, those things you will describe in detail in the case study. If you're talking about only one single patient, which is little bit deviated from the normal presentations. Okay, that is called as case study. You present one person has come with varicose vein, the presentation is a little bit different compared to the normal presentation of the varicose vein. So it felt that it is should be documented, you document that. Okay, that becomes a case study over a period of time, say like 5 to 10 years or 5 years or 2 years, like that. You find out that when you're in your practicing area, in your area, the people are coming with varicose vein are having the same presentation as you presented as you seen last patient, one patient. Okay, you've seen the same similar patients, like 5 to 10 patients. You feel that it's a little bit very common in your particular community rather than in other areas. Okay, so you feel that it may be a little bit deviation from the normal thing. So what you're doing, all the 5 to 10 cases of the varicose vein, which are little bit deviated from the normal presentation, you made a list of them and you wrote about their presentation, what they presented, what the signs and symptoms, what their investigation reports, and you wrote about their surgical procedures and what complication they faced and all. Okay, so then you written about 5 to 10 cases, then it becomes case series. In case study, you reported only about one case study or case report, you just told about one case, whereas in case series, you're talking about around 5 to 10 cases of similar nature. Okay, which may be similar nature of that particular community, or maybe deviated from the same normal presentations. Okay, that is case series. Okay, next one is, when you see in case study and case, you felt that case series, why this is happening in my area? You may feel that why this is happening in my area, like these varicose vein people, varicose vein presenting like this. Okay, in such scenario, you are thinking, why this may be happening? Why this may be happening? How many people are like that maybe in my area? So you got a curiosity. So you wanted to do the survey, immediate survey, to know how many people may be suffering like this varicose vein, this type of particular presentation varicose vein in your, in your taluk. Okay, you with the help of the team, you did this immediate survey. You want to do immediate survey. Then it becomes a cross-sectional study. So if you want to do the, how many people are having the, what is the prevalence of this type of particular varicose vein presentation in your taluk, if you're doing that with the help of health team, then it becomes cross-sectional study. So when you want to check the prevalence, okay, we have to use the cross-sectional study. Here, just I want to tell one thing. Cross-sectional study is related to time frame. When I'm talking about cross-sectional study, with time frame means I will examine the patient, or I'll come across the patient or the person only one time. Okay, I'm not following it up them again. Only once I'll go, what is your name? I'll ask, and what is your age? I'll ask, and I'll come back. That is cross-sectional study. I will not go again of next day. I'll go and ask again, what are you doing and all. That is not cross-sectional study. If I'm going to the any person one time and asking some question, then it becomes cross-sectional study. It's like a photo. Okay, that is cross-sectional study. If here, what I did in case study, I just got one case. Then when I observed over a period of time, over 1 year to 2 years, I got some similar cases. So I reported that as a case series, but I got a curiosity. Why these people are presenting like this? How many people are presenting like this? Okay, I did some survey, immediate survey I did to know how many people are having this type of varicose vein in this area. That becomes a cross-sectional study. So when you check in descriptive study, we can only tell about the numbers. We cannot tell about the reasons. So we cannot clearly tell what is the reason for this patient to develop this particular disease or this particular type of presentation. So we have to go to next level of study designs. These are called as analytical study designs. In descriptive studies, we just described these number of patients are having the disease. These number of patients are having the, these number of patients have been cured. Okay. So in analytical study, we go one step ahead and try to analyze what may be the reasons for these patients or this group to develop the disease. Okay. So in that case, we have to do the analytical study. In analytical study designs, we're having only two types of analytical study. In cross-sectional study, you don't think what I'm showing. This is for PG level, just for only for UG level, I'm trying to tell. There are only two types. One is cohort study, other one is case control study. Okay. When you're talking about analytical study, like case control study and cohort study, you have to think about one thing, whether outcome has already occurred. Or disease already occurred. If disease already occurred, you have to do the case control study. If disease is not yet occurred, you have the exposure, but disease is not yet occurred, outcome is not yet occurred, then you have to follow them over a period of time to check about the outcome. Then you have to do the cohort study. Okay, so in analytical study, we're having only two types, that is case control study and cohort study. When we are talking about case control study, we have to look for whether outcome has already happened. If the outcome has already happened, we are going to check in back in time whether what may be the reasons, what are the exposures this patient is having to develop this disease. Okay. Whereas in cohort study, what we do, person has not developed any disease. They are just having the exposure or risk factors they're having. So if we follow them over a period of time, say 5 years, 10 years, some people among the exposure group may develop the disease. Okay. So if its outcome is already happened, we have to go for the case control study. If outcome is not yet occurred, then you have to go for the cohort study. Okay. So if you're having any doubt now, you can ask me. Because if you understood here, going to next slides will be a little bit easier. Shravan, you can start sharing.
Yes, sir. Just 1 second. I'm sharing.
Yeah. Go to next. Yeah. Can you go to previous slide? Okay, next slide. Okay, sorry. Okay, sir, cross-section study can be in both descriptive and analytical, sir. Yes, actually, cross-section study can be both in descriptive study and analytical study. When you're doing with a comparison group in cross-section study, it can be an analytical study. that is a little bit different. For UG level, that is not required. That's why I'm not talking about it. So it will be confusion for you. So descriptive study, cross-section study is a descriptive study. So keep in like that only. In advanced means if you have some modification with the in the cross-section study with the comparison group and all, then it may become the analytical study also. Cross-section study won't give a Y answer. Yes. So cross-section studies will not tell about the reasons. It will only tell about the number. It will tell about the prevalence. Okay. It will tell about the prevalence of the particular disease. Okay. In some, while doing analysis of the results, while doing analysis of the data, what we can do with available data, we can just try to ascertain what may be the reason. We may generate hypothesis. Okay. If we see the descriptive study designs are mainly to help us to generate the hypothesis. Okay, so why people may be asking cross-section study, why it will not give the Y answer? Because we're just doing a simple survey. Okay, we are not going in detail about the what is the reason and all. Okay, so we'll discuss about that when it comes to other part, analytical study design. In cross-section study, sometimes what we do, when we do the analysis part, when we're doing the analysis part, we may, within the population, we may do the chi-square test. We do the comparison, stratification we'll do, male, female, age group and all. Okay. And we compare that and we may say this number of age group people are having higher risk for to develop the disease. But that is not conclusive. Okay. That is not conclusive what we get in the cross-section study. That is just a hypothesis. It is helping us to make the hypothesis. So you have to, with that hypothesis, you may have to go for the other analytical study design, like case control study or cohort study with little bit modification with comparison group. You can go for the cross-section study also. It may be a little confusing for you. That's why I'm not talking about cross-section study in the analytical this one. Yeah, this we'll discuss. Clinical profile of preparation we'll discuss when I come to later. Okay, so can you see the example one? In a study to find out the risk factors of liver cancer, 30 liver cancer patients were compared with 60 normal persons. Okay. 30 liver cancer patients were compared with 60 normal persons. 7 of the liver cancer patients and 10 of the normal subjects gave history of previous hepatitis B infection. So what studies design we can do for this?
Both study.
First one, which one can be done?
The case control, because the outcome has already occurred.
Yes, outcome has already occurred. Second one, can you 5,000 smokers are there and a similar number of non-smokers are there in our state were followed for a period of 1 year to study the occurrence of coronary heart disease. There were 250 cases among the smokers and 100 cases among the non-smokers. So which case study should be used for this? Second one is correct.
Cohort,
correct. Correct. Can you go to next slide, Shravan? Okay. So this is one more example I'm just showing. In a study of the effect of diabetes on the development of the ischemic heart disease, 1,500 diabetic patients and 1,500 age and sex matched normal adults were followed up for an average period of 12 years. Okay. There were 98 events of IHD in diabetic patients compared to 16 events of IHD in the normal persons during the 12 years of observation. So what study design are you going to use?
Case control, sir.
Can you just see? It's cohort. Correct. Somebody has mentioned cohort. Why? Because why it is cohort? I will just.
Okay. Sir, can I answer, sir?
Yeah, you can answer.
So because you are following the diabetic and non-diabetic normal adults for the period of 12 years. So since you're following up them from when they did not have a disease till a stage where some of them present a disease, it will come under cohort study.
Yes, yes. Why I put this particular question is because here what we are doing is diabetes also disease. Correct. Diabetes also disease, but diabetes is a risk factor we're taking for the ischemic heart disease. Okay. As I told, diabetes, even though diabetes is a disease, but what we're trying to find risk factor for the ischemic heart disease. Okay. And we're following them over a period of 12 years. When we talk about follow, it always core study. Okay, correct. So can we go to next slide? Okay. This is actually 10 mark question, long essay question we asked in our university. Usually Kerala, this is the type of question they ask in for 10 marks. Sanjana is a recent MBBS graduate who is working as a medical officer in a primary health center. There are a number of patients present to her with signs of jaundice. Okay. A local traditional medical practitioner tells her about the usefulness of a special plant in the treatment of jaundice. She decides to test the plant. So what type of study design it is? Yes, it's experimental, correct. Why? Because we are doing some intervention. Yes, RCT. If she should use the RCT, okay. Here, what is the intervention she is doing? She wanted to use some special plant as a treatment. Okay, so can you go to next slide?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. A third year MBBS student during his clinical posting, patients had leukoplakia in the oral cavity. He wanted to find the risk factors for leukoplakia. What is the reason should be used?
Sir, cohort study.
Okay. Leukoplakia is also already, this is outcome.
Okay.
So it should be case control.
Yes.
Okay. So when they decrease the size of the question, no, it will be a little bit difficult for the students to understand. That's why I kept this question purposely. Okay. So here, what important catching point we have to observe is this is already occurred. Outcome is already occurred. What is the disease in question we are talking about is leukoplakia. So outcome is already occurred. In such scenario, it's better to go for the case control study. Okay, can you go to the next slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So as a medical officer recently recruited in a primary health center, you find that there is a cotton mill in your area and its workers utilize your health services. You want to investigate whether their health is affected by the work environment. What type of study design you have to use? What type of study design we can use for this? See, can you see, you want to investigate whether their health is affected by the work environment. Work environment is a risk factor. So it is a cohort. Okay, it's a cohort. We are not doing any intervention, but just we're trying to observe whether the work environment is having any effect on the outcome, like say COPD or asbestosis or cotton mill means brucellosis. Okay. So is there any effect going to happen because of the work environment? So this is the example for the cohort. Okay. So we have to talk about the cohort study here. Can you go to
next? I have a small doubt here.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
Sir, yeah. In this, if they had added one more statement telling that, to investigate whether their health is affected by the work environment, mm-hmm. by putting few of the workers with a face mask or something like that. So, will that?
If they had also, that is also respect, because here it has not been occurred. Correct.
Okay. Yes,
so
sir.
This is not yet occurred. So it will. We have to go for the cohort study. Even if you add that part also with mask, without mask also, it also becomes the part of the cohort study only.
Okay, yes, sir.
Okay, because with mask will become one group, without mask will become the other group.
Okay, sir.
Okay, yeah. This is the next slide. Okay, fast recap, okay? So mainly we're having two types of study designs. One is observation, other one is experimental. Can you go to the next slide? Okay, so in observation, what we are having is descriptive and analytical. So if there are any intervention we are doing, intervention means not only drugs, okay? Even if I'm doing any intervention such as even if it is if I'm doing any intervention even for the health education component, okay, then it becomes the experimental study design. Okay, somebody has asked, sir, for that mask one won't be experimental. See, to say that mask as the, if you are using a protective gear, as a mask as a protective gear, then it becomes a, you're not supposed to say that mask is a intervention. It's a tool. Yes, I agree. But according to the laws, according to the labor laws and industry law, you have to provide mask for in a cotton mill. Okay. If you're not providing that, then it becomes a legal. So in that context only, we're telling it's a, it should be a cohort study. In that scenario, for example, if we go 20 years back, 50 years, 30 years back, 50 years back, in that case, you're providing mask. And then that time it may be experimental study design. I agree. But in this scenario, it is a duty of the employer to provide the mask in a cotton mill. Okay, because it is already proved under the Factory Act and other disease Factory Act and Labor Act, you have to provide some safety requirements, safety equipments. Okay, so in that scenario only, we are not supposed to take it as an experimental study design. Okay, but it should be taken as an analytical study design or nothing but cohort study design. Okay, yeah.
Yes.
So yeah, in observational study design. In experimental study design, even if we talk about health education, for example, I will go to the any community and I'll say 50 mothers are there. 50 mothers, I'll give education regarding the breastfeeding. Okay. And 50 mothers, I will not give anything about the health education about the breastfeeding. And I observe there about the complaints with the exclusive breastfeeding in the both the groups. Okay. What I'm doing is I'm giving intervention as a health education. Okay, here intervention is health education. In that scenario, you can use it as a RCT. Okay, technically it will become RCT if you're doing proper randomized allocation and all. Okay, otherwise any intervention for that matter. Usually what we think RCT means, we only think about vaccines, we think about drugs, and we think about other things and all. Okay, but we don't think about health education component. Health education component also can become an intervention. Okay, yeah, can you go to next slide? Okay, distribution, next. Yeah, I already explained this. Okay, just see the title, acute vision loss in postpartum period as presenting symptom of HIV associated cryptococcal meningitis. What type of study design it is? I'm just doing recap, okay, because if you see many, many examples, only it will be easy for you to understand. It's a single patient. So what may be the
case study?
Yeah. Can you go to next slide?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. It's a case report or case study. Next one. So the New England Journal of Medicine, what did pneumocystis carinii pneumonia and mucosal candidiasis in previously healthy homosexual men. So here, evidence of new acquired cellular immunodeficiency. So they're talking about the presentation of pneumocystis carinii pneumonia and mucosal candidiasis in a homosexual man as a series. Okay, so can you just go to next slide? So this will be case series. This is example for the case series. Go to next slide. Next slide. Okay, so here you see prevalence and determinants of hypertension in the urban rural population of a North Indian district. Okay, so I told you prevalence, which study can be used to check the prevalence?
Sir, cross-sectional study.
Cross-sectional, yes, cross-sectional. Also, I told cross-sectional is a descriptive study and we cannot see for the risk, we cannot ascertain the risk factors, correct? But we are mentioned the determinants of the hypertension. Okay, so this is the confusion what people may get as a cross-sectional, means when we talk about cross-sectional. Among the prevalent group, what we're trying to analyze the determinants is among the prevalent group, what are the reasons may be the, what are the risk factors for the people to develop the hypertension? That's what we're talking in the cross-sectional study. Okay, that's why it is descriptive study. We try to analyze the results and we arrive at a hypothesis. Based on this hypothesis, if you want to do the next level of investigation, you have to use for the analytical study designs, maybe case control or maybe the cohort study. Okay, next one. Okay, this is an example for the cross-section study. Next. I just kept every slide. Okay, so any study designs. So we are having mainly two types of design, mainly two types, observation and experiment. If there is any intervention, you take it as experimental. In experimental, we are having two types, that is RCT and non-RCT. Okay, in observation, we are having, if it is no intervention is there, we talk about it as an observation. You just stand outside and you just observe it. Then it is observation study. In observation, we are having two types. One is descriptive study, other one is analytical study. In description study, we just describe. We don't talk anything about the what is the reason. Okay, that is descriptive study design. That is case report, case series, cross-sectional study designs. Okay, next one, next slide. In analytical, we are having two types of study design. That is case control and cohort. Okay, next. Okay, risk factors for development of colorectal carcinoma. So this is example for the case control. Can you go to next slide? Yeah, next slide. Okay, so one of the best example for the cohort study is Framingham HAT study. So in your PARC textbook, they have given for Framingham HAT study. You can read about it. And one of the longest followed cohort study is this Framingham HAT study. Okay, whatever we risk factors, we're talking about ischemic heart disease or cardiovascular diseases. Almost 60-70% of the results have come, or the recommendations have come from this Framingham HAT study only. Almost 50% of the results are what guidelines we're talking about, cholesterol, salt intake, blood pressure cutoff, everything is coming from this study, cohort study. Yeah, next. In case one analytical, we're having case one on cohort. Next. Yeah. So here, can you see a comparison between inhalational and total intravenous anesthesia, that is propofol and dexamethasone, in improving post-operative recovery for morbidly obese patient and undergoing laparoscopic sleeve gastrectomy? What you're doing here, you're comparing between two drugs. Okay. So which type of study design it is? Can you go to next slide? It is RCT. Okay. In experimental study design, we're having randomized control and non-randomized control. Okay, next slide. Okay, so whatever I told last examples I showed now, here I wanted you to observe I bolded the important points to look in any question, any scenarios, if you come across. First, look for the what you look for. First, you look for any intervention is happening. Okay. If intervention is happening, then it becomes experimental study design. If no intervention, then you make maybe observation study designs. If in observation study design, you look for any, we're just having comparison groups or not. If comparison group is there, it will be analytical study design. There are no comparison group, it will be descriptive study designs. In descriptive, we're having case series, case report, cross-section study, and these things. In analytical study, we're having case control and cohort study. Okay, so when you talk about analytical study design, you look for the outcome, whether outcome has already occurred. So if you see this in first scenario, liver cancer already occurred. We are comparing with whom we are comparing? We're comparing with the 60 normal persons. Okay, it's a cases and controls. So the first example is case control study. In case control study, what we do, what analysis we do, I'm not going in detail about the each step, okay? I'm just trying to tell important points. We'll discuss in future each study design in detail. Can anybody tell what analysis we'll do to find out association between the disease in case control study? We do odds ratio, okay? We do odds ratio to calculate the association between the disease and the risk factor. Okay, in the second scenario, if you see 5,000 smokers are there, similar number of non-smokers are there. What you're doing is following over a period of time. Whenever you talk about following up, okay, that is surely it is cohort study. Okay, in cohort study also we are having different type of study, cohort study that we don't discuss, we no need to bother at this point of time. Whenever we talk about follow-up is there, it should be cohort study. Okay, can we go in cohort study, what we do for the analysis to check the association between the disease and our risk factor, we do relative risk. Okay, yeah, can you go to next slide? Yeah, this is just 2x2 table for the examples what I given. First example I talked about case control study, and second example what I'm giving is the for the cohort study. In case control study, when you're writing the case control study 2x2 table, so always we should write the hello.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, we should write the outcome in the columns. Okay, and whereas in case control study we have to write the exposure in the rows and outcome also in the column. Okay, so in case control study we do odds ratio. What is odds ratio? Odds ratio is nothing but indirect measurement of the association. Okay, we do usually case control study for the rare diseases. Okay, rare diseases. So in odds ratio what we'll do, we do cross multiplication. For example, in this table, 7 is we give a HCC minus positive and minus negative is there, no? 7 is A, 10 is B, 23 is C, 50 is D. So what we do, cross multiply. The odds ratio formula is AD divided by BC. Okay, AD divided by BC. We do cross multiplication and we come across the results. Okay, we come across. For example, odds ratio is equal to, we got some, when you calculate this example, we get odds ratio of 1.52. So what is that? What is the meaning of that? What is 1.52? What is the meaning of that? So in odds ratio, when you do cross multiplication, if it is equal to 1, if odds ratio is equal to 1, the disease and the risk factor is not having any contributing factor for the disease to develop. That is what is odds ratio is equal to 1 means. If the odds ratio is more than 1, it means there is a chance for the disease. For example, the risk factor is a causative factor for the disease. In this scenario, hepatitis B is a cause factor for the hepatocellular carcinoma. Okay, then it's how much times? It's 1.52 times is a risk for the patient to develop the hepatitis. Those who are having hepatitis B, they're having 1.52 higher time have the risk of developing the hepatocellular carcinoma. Okay, that is the meaning of odds ratio. Okay, if it is less than 1, usually we get less than one during vaccine trials and all. So if it is less than 1, what it means, the risk factor what we're thinking, it is not a risk factor, it's a protective factor. Okay, for example, we talking about say coconut oil consumption and the cardiovascular diseases. Okay, you got an odds ratio of 1, odds ratio of 0.8. Then it indicates that coconut oil consumption is a protective factor for the cardiovascular diseases. Okay, I'm just giving an example. It may be not true. I'm just giving the example. When it goes to cohort studies, we usually calculate the relative risk. Okay, to calculate the relative risk, you should calculate the incidence. Okay, so what we do, we calculate the incidence among the exposed group. In this example, smokers are the exposed group, non-smokers are the unexposed group. So we calculate the incidence among the exposed group and incidence among the non-exposed group. After that, we calculate the relative risk. So what is the relative risk formula? Relative risk formula is incidence among exposed divided by incidence among the non-exposed. Okay, so incidence among exposed divided by incidence among the non-exposed. So if we get the relative risk as 1, it means there is no association between the disease and the risk factor. For example, in this scenario only, if you take smoking and non-smoking with the cardiovascular diseases, if I get a relative risk of 1, it means that smoking as doesn't have any effect on the cardiovascular diseases. That is the meaning of relative risk of is equal to 1. If relative risk is more than 1, it means smoking is a risk factor for the patient to develop the cardiovascular disease. Okay, for example, if I say 2, relative risk is of 2, it means compared to non-smokers, smokers having 2 times higher risk of developing the cardiovascular diseases. That is the meaning of relative risk is equal to more than 1. If it is relative risk less than 1, say I'm given the vaccine and number of people got the vaccine for the diphtheria and number of people not developed the diphtheria. If I say relative risk is less than 1, it means the DPT diphtheria vaccine is having protective effect against the developing the disease diphtheria. That is relative risk is less than 1. Okay. So there is one more concept called as attributable risk. So relative risk is exact measure of the, we can almost, because since we are following it over a period of time, okay, we can tell that this number of times, for example, if I say 2 times, our relative risk is 2, relative risk is 3, relative risk is 3.5, means that many time a patient is having highest risk of developing the exposed group is having that much risk of developing the particular disease in what we're talking. Okay, so there is one more thing called as attributable risk. So attributable risk is nothing but incidence among the exposed minus incidence among non-exposed divided by incidence among the exposed. So incidence among unexposed. It usually gives about the some, for example, it will give as a percentage. Okay, usually into 100 we have to do. It will give us a percentage. For example, if I say attributable risk as for the smoking and cardiovascular diseases, around say 80%. So what it means? What it means? If I can attribute. Attribute means I can easily say that around 100 cases of cardiovascular diseases in the community are having the history of smoking. In other way, around 80% of the cardiovascular diseases occurring in the community are having the history of smoking. Okay, that is the meaning of attributable risk. It means I can, in a community, if there are 100 cases of cardiovascular disease happening, and 80% of the cases are happening because of the smoking. That is the meaning of attributable risk. There is one more concept called as population attributable risk. This is very, very important for the to frame any guidelines related to any prevention as activities. So what is that? The population attributable risk means, if that is also expressed in percentage. If I say for example, CHD and smoking, population attributable risk is around 70%. What it means, 70%, what it means? See, calculation we can easily do. With the nowadays availability of the all online facilities, we can do easily, very easily we can do the calculation. But interpretation, here comes our knowledge about the epidemiology. Okay, so what is population attributable risk? If I say 70% of population attributable risk for the smoking and CHD, it means if I do prevention, if I say that if I cut off smoking in my community completely, okay, 70% of the CHD cases can be prevented. That is the meaning of population attributable risk. This population attributable risk is very, very important for the public health aspect, especially to frame the preventive guidelines. Okay, I hope you understood. If you have any doubt regarding relative risk, odds ratio, attributable risk and population attributable risk, can ask now. Okay, so if no doubts, we'll go to next slide. Next slide. Okay, same. I'm just giving the important point to be seen in the examples. Whenever we see any scenario, you should look for the important points followed up for a period of 12 years, then it should be cohort study. Yeah, next. Okay, here also she decides to test the plant. So it's a experimental study. Okay, she's intervening. Yeah, next. Yeah, so she's wanted to check for the risk factors for the leukoplakia. Leukoplakia has already occurred. That's why it is case control study design. Yeah, next. Okay, cotton mill in your area. Their health is affected by the work environment. So cotton mill is there. You want to check the work environment affecting their disease in future. So you have to do the cohort study. Yeah. Go next, next. You can go. Yeah. So prevalence. Yeah, previous. Yeah. So prevalence anemia can be done by Mr. Prof. study design.
So cross-sectional study.
Yeah. Clinical profile of leptospirosis.
So case series.
Case series can be done. Even if you want to go in detail about next step, you can do the cross-section study also. But you're talking about only few cases, then it should be case series or case report. If you're reporting about only one patient, then it will be case report. If you're reporting about number of patients, like 5 to 10 patients, it becomes case series. Yeah, next one. Risk factors for low birth weight. We can go for the
so you can do both cohort and case control, no sir, in this case.
Yes. Risk factor for low birth weight, you can do both low birth case control and cohort. You have to, for example, you are doing I'll just explain risk factor for low birth weight. If I'm doing already people, I'm examining the patients already born with low birth weight patients, I'm observing, means then it is case control. I am checking the already low birth weight born babies and comparing with the normal birth weight babies, then it becomes case control study. If I'm following over all the mothers, okay, if I'm following over the all the mothers and then checking how many people are having low birth weight and how many people are not having normal birth weight, then it becomes cohort study. You're able to understand, Shravan?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Outcome, at what point of time you're doing the study, that decides the whether it's cross-section study or whether it's the case control study. Okay. Yeah. So next one is conventional suture versus stapler. So conventional suture versus stapler, here where I'm comparing with the stapler is already, conventional suture is already traditional one. So you have to bring the stapler to newer thing. So it's a experimental study. Okay. It's RCT. Okay. So,
I have one doubt here, sir. Yes. Sir, in this case, can't you also look at it as a cohort study, taking that suture is one group, yes, stable?
Very, very good question. See, if I'm already using conventional suture, I'm already using stapler in my scenario. Okay. I'm already using staplers for my doing study, in my practice. Okay.
Yes, sir.
If I am doing that time comparing with these two, then it is cohort study. Okay. First time I'm trying to introduce stapler into my practice, then it becomes
interventional.
Okay. You're able to understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And some people are asking about what is the difference between RCT and non-RCT. Can I just explain that? If we have time?
Yes, sir. We have time, sir.
Okay. So what is the difference between RCT and non-RCT? So the main difference between RCT and non-RCT is RCT means randomization. What is randomization? So randomization, we say that it's a process where everybody in the study group will get an equal chance to get into the study group. Okay, for example, I want to do a study among the diabetic, I want to check a new drug for the diabetes. So what I will do, I will do the two group, one going to the new drug group, other one is the old drug group. So when I do the randomization, like flipping a coin, toss, when we do the toss, we don't know which, we have 50-50 chance that it may fall head or it may fall tails, correct? So we have that randomization. And our lottery method, even if you take lottery method, we don't know everybody. For example, if I want to take the 30 people into the study group in the experimental group, like new drug group, and 30 people into the old drug group. What we do, 60 names we'll keep into the chit, and we take first one to the drug group. And when we're doing that, everybody is having the equal chance getting into the study group, say experimental group or the non-experimental group. Okay, that is called as randomization. Randomization itself is a big topic. It's a short notes, or maybe it may short notes. Sometime we'll discuss about what is the main difference between non-RCT means. For example, if I do systematically, I do calculate random numbers. Then I say every person, for example, every third person is going to come to my clinic will go to the experimental group. Other two people will go to the old drug group. Then it becomes RCT. Okay. If I do just randomly, without asserting, for example, okay, today if one person is coming, okay, go for a new drug group. If one other person is coming, I just say you go for the other old drug group. There is no rule. If I'm not following any rule, then it becomes non-RCT. Okay, that is non-RCT. Randomization itself is a big topic. We'll discuss sometime. I hope Sonakshi understood. You can just say, yeah. Okay, one more doubt some people asked. 1 minute. Okay. Yeah. So one important point I want to tell you guys, whenever you study case control study or cross-section study, cohort study, they always ask about the difference between the case control study and cohort study. Please read about it. One few things I just tell. The difference between the main prevalent cohort study and the case control study is in cohort study, we are following up for a period of time. So what is the disease? Here we are checking from the risk factor to exposure to outcome. We are checking from the exposure to outcome. Whereas in case control study, outcome is already happened. So we are checking from the outcome to exposure. Cohort study is also called as prospective study, follow-up study, and all. In case control study, is called as retrospective study. So we are going back in time. Okay, and usually we do case control study for rare diseases. Okay, in cohort study we do for the commonly occurring diseases, and case control study we can calculate incidence. Okay, whereas in cohort in cohort study we can calculate incidence, whereas in case control study we cannot calculate incidence. So what is incidence? Is what is incidence? Incidence is nothing but occurrence of new cases in a community. Okay, to check occurrence of new cases, you should know it should be happening in front of us. Then only we can say this is new case. Okay, so that's why we cannot calculate incidence in a case control study. We can calculate incidence only in cohort study. We say it is temporality. So when we talk about temporality, we can calculate incidence in cohort study, whereas we cannot calculate incidence in case control study. Next one is, in cohort study, we use relative risk to check the association, whereas in case control study, we calculate odds ratio to check the association between the risk factor and the disease. Okay, these are the main important differences. And if you have any doubts, you can ask. Okay, so if there are no doubts,
even on YouTube, there are no doubts.
Okay. Yeah. So just read about different type. So what is the take home message? For whenever you see any study design, first look for the, is there any experimental intervention is happening? Okay. If there is intervention is happening, then it will become experimental study designs. If it is randomly doing, it becomes RCT. If it is we're doing non-randomly, it becomes non-RCT. If there are no intervention, it becomes observational. In observation, you look for whether is there any comparison groups, either two groups are there. If two groups are there, it becomes analytical. If there are no two groups, if there only one group is there, then it becomes descriptive study design. Okay, in descriptive study design, we are having case series, case report, case series, and cross-section study. Here we can just describe the numbers. We cannot exactly tell the why this is happening. Okay, what is the reason for this is to happen? Okay, to understand that, we can, in descriptive study, we can only generate the hypothesis. Whereas to test the hypothesis, you have to go for the higher study designs, that is case control study, cohort study, and RCT. Okay, so in analytical study, if you're checking for the already outcome has occurred, if outcome is already occurred, then it is, you have to use the case control study. If outcome is not yet occurred, your following the or them over a period of time, whether the outcome is happening or not, then it should be cohort study. Okay, just one point I want to add here. We always ask about the hierarchy of the evidence. Okay, when you talk about the hierarchy of evidence of the study designs, whatever we talk today, RCT is the having the highest evidence value. Okay, if I say I did a study based on case series and I'm telling about this is correct means, and same study has been done by some other person with RCT, the evidence, which evidence will be having more value is RCT value. RCT evidence will be having more value compared to the cross-section study or case control study. Okay, first one is highest among the what we discussed today is RCT. Apart from that, above RCT we are having meta-analysis or systemic reviews. The systemic review and meta-analysis of this one, it is having the highest value compared to the RCT. Also, what we do in meta-analysis, we do the analysis review of the so many RCT studies and we come across some conclusions. That is meta-analysis or systemic review. Okay, that is the topmost. Next one is RCT. Next one is cohort. Next one is case control study. Next one is cross-section study. Next case series, then case report. This is the hierarchy what we are following. Least is case report. Highest one is meta-analysis or systemic analysis. Okay. If thank you for the opportunity. If you're having any doubts, we can.
So I think, sir, it was a very clear session, sir. And I think all those examples you gave made.
It was a good revision for me, sir. Tilak, sir. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Good revision, sir. And you made it very simple. The best thing was the with example, you gave so many examples so that we could relate and we can understand better and we can remember that way with examples. Otherwise, theory, it's very confusing, sir.
Yes.
You gave such good examples now we can remember better now.
Yeah.
Understanding is one thing, remembering is second thing. So you made it both very clear. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes. I just wanted to tell one slide. I repeatedly put one slide. Correct, Shravan?
Yes, sir.
That
share slide, that again, sir.
Yeah. I'm just telling all the students who participate today, you always look for that that slide. That screen you keep it in your mind. Means first look for that flow chart. First, look for the any experiment is happening. This one. If any experiment is happening, this always like go like this. Then if you go doing like that, even in your NEET entrance exam, you won't find any difficulties. Okay. So what I discussed today is very simple examples. Okay. In this, they will twist in with some small twist. They will ask NEET exam entrance exams questions. So if you do, instead of doing case control, if you do cohort, your answers will be wrong. So it will change the entire ranking in your exams. Okay. So just always take extra 1 minute and try to observe. Okay. Whether it is following any pattern of this. Yeah. So if everything is fine, then we can.
Sir, please send us the PPT, sir. We shall share it in the groups also.
Yeah.
I have taken a screenshot of this particular slide so that everyone will have. I'll share it in all the groups and everywhere so that we can revise it repeatedly.
Yes. That is actually the Lancet journals, this one. Okay. So this is how usually simple methods only we have to keep in mind. Yeah. Okay. If it's a great opportunity for me and if people are interested to learn each study design, we can do that also in future. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. It was a very good session, sir. And it cleared all our doubts. And like you said, sir, we'll get cleared even more if we continue to practice more of these sessions. I mean, with more examples and things like that.
Yes.
So, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.